All right, Mark chapter number 11. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We look into it tonight and we see these things that in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ and his determination and dedication to accomplish his purposes. We just pray these things might encourage our hearts and instruct us so that we can trust you more fully. And we thank you for that in Christ's name. Amen. All right, we're going to start the 11th chapter of the book of Mark now. And this, you know, I've said to you as we've been studying through, we're moving into the last week of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ before his crucifixion. We're only just, actually, you're only, with this passage, you're 5 days before the cross. And you're in chapter 11. Now, there's a lot of things going to take place when he dies in chapter 15. So there's a lot of territory still yet to cover. But time-wise, we're right down at the end. And the first part of Mark 11, you have what is the Christ's entry into Jerusalem. This passage, his entry into Jerusalem, in the religious calendar is called Palm Sunday. It's called the Triumphal Entry, and that, all that's just religious hoodly-doo. But all four of the accounts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, record this instance. It's very seldom that all four record the same thing. And so there's a lot of stuff in this passage, and there's way too much in it for us to go over in just one pass. So I'm going to go down through the passage tonight and then and kind of introduce some things in it, and then we'll pick up the pieces as we go. But there's a tremendous amount of material from here on out that carries a great deal of weight, and there's just an awful lot of information. And anything that all four counts, I was thinking about trying to compare all four of them. I'm not going to do that. We're studying Mark, so we'll study the way Mark does it. But I'll point out a few things along the way. But it's important to understand, at this point, you know, all through the life of Christ, he said, mine hour is not yet come. He knows he isn't going to die right then. Now he knows his hour has come. And the time of his departure is at hand. And he knows that the time schedule is there. And so he's going to call attention to his entry into Jerusalem. Up until this point, he's not called attention to himself. Over and over, he's told people, don't tell them who I am. Don't, you know, he's withdrawn himself. But now he's going to present himself to Jerusalem and to Israel through that in a way to call attention that, hey, I've come to town. And there's some reasons for that. The first thing you want to notice is that the events that take place here are really the fulfillment of prophecy. Let's just read down through the first few verses. And when they came nigh to Jerusalem unto Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent forth two of his disciples and said unto them, go your way into the village over against you, and soon as you enter into it, you shall find a colt tied, whereupon never man sat. Loose him and bring him. And if any man say unto you, why do you do this? Say ye that the Lord hath need of him. And straightway he will send him hither. And they went their way and found the colt tied by the door without in a place where two ways met. And they loosed him. And certain of them that stood there said unto him, what do ye, loosing the colt? And they said unto him, even as Jesus had commanded them, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and cast their garments on him, and he sat on him. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cast down branches off the trees and strayed them in the way. And they that went before and they that followed after cried, saying, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now that's a quote from Psalm 118. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. So this entry into Jerusalem at this point, and the crowd that's there, they proclaim him. And it's interesting how it says it in verse 9. They that went before and they that followed cried saying, Hosanna. That is, Jehovah save us, God save us. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Notice they understand the nature of the kingdom that they're expecting. Now, if when he says, Mark records it, blessed be the kingdom of our father David, that ought to remind you, if you go back to chapter 10 with Bartimaeus, what did he say in chapter 10, verse 47? When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. It wasn't that he was just Jesus of Nazareth. You're the Messiah. You're the one that's going to bring the kingdom of our father David. And with Bartimaeus, we saw last time, he's blind Bartimaeus, but God gives right there before he enters into Jerusalem, before he goes in there to die, you have this blind man get his sight back, and it's sort of that pledge of the victory that Christ is going to accomplish as he goes to Jerusalem. This is the outcome of him going. So in chapter 11, he begins to go, and you know, Mark doesn't quote a lot of these passages. He just quotes the one in Psalm. If you go to Matthew and Luke and John, they quote Zechariah chapter 9 about he's come on the colt, the foal of an ass and so forth. We'll see that. But what's happening here is he's fulfilling prophecy. Come back with me, if you will, to the book of Daniel, chapter number 9. You get Daniel 9 in one hand and Luke chapter 9. Now, Luke is the parallel passage, Luke 19, I'm sorry, is the parallel passage in Luke for the entry. And when you see this, you begin to see that there's stuff going on here that is really more than just this is a prophetic presentation of the Messiah to the nation Israel, but in a very special way. It's not the entrance that people are expecting with the religious system out there, the triumphal entry. It's something entirely different than that, and yet it's the clear fulfillment of prophecy. In Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, he's Daniel the prophet, Jesus calls him in Matthew 24. He's not a historian. He's a prophet. He's telling the future. And he gives a time schedule for the times of the Gentiles. God had established the nation Israel in the earth to be his kingdom nation. When they apostatized, turned their back on their responsibility, God sent them into captivity. And he warned them in Leviticus 26, there are five different courses of judgment. And when they finally matriculate to the last one, they're sent off into captivity. And politically, they lose the opportunity to be the head of the nations until Christ comes back. You get a picture of the course of Gentile rule in Daniel 2 with the image of Nebuchadnezzar. And he goes through not just the Babylonian captivity, but Jeremiah told him, said there'll be kings after that. And so you learn who they are in Jeremiah 2. When you come to Daniel 9, he gives you the time schedule for the times of the Gentiles, and more importantly, the restoration of Israel. So it says in verse 24, Daniel 9, 24, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and thy holy city. Now they'd been in Babylon for 70 years. Now they're going to be 70 weeks of years. In your Bible, a week can be a week of days, it can be a week of months, it can be a week of years, it can be a week of weeks of years, it can be a lot of different kind of things. It's a week as a unit of seven somethings. And in this case, it's going to be 7 years. So when it says 70 weeks, he's talking about 490 years. It's going to take that much time to cleanse the nation while they're in captivity. The reason for the 70 weeks, and you notice they're upon thy people and thy holy city. The 70 weeks are aimed at the discipline of the nation Israel and the city of Jerusalem, to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring an everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the psalm and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Those six things will be accomplished during those 70 weeks in order to cleanse and restore the nation Israel. Know therefore, verse 25, and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and rebuild and build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street should be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Now that's not really when you look at that, we've been all this stuff so much that sometimes I think it's not necessary for me to go over this, but there are people that aren't here all the time. He says in the passage, from the commandment to go forth and rebuild Jerusalem. So there's a point in time where they know the prophecy is going to begin. That commandment takes place in Nehemiah chapter number 2. He says, after that commandment starts, you can start counting. And you're going to go 7 weeks. That'll be 49 years. And then the wall's going to be rebuilt. Then you're going to go 62 weeks. That's going to be 434 years. This will be a period of 483 altogether. And after that's over with, Messiah's going to be cut off. Jerusalem's going to be destroyed. Then there's going to be another week out over here, the 70th week, that last seven-year period of time. At the end of the 69 weeks, 72 and 62, at the end of them, he says they're after, verse 25, I can find verse 25. There it is. And know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. So after the 69th week, you're going to have Messiah cut off. Now, the cutting off of the Messiah in Isaiah 53 is his crucifixion. Now, come with me. So, you understand, from this point here, Nehemiah chapter 2, to that point there, they can count the years. They know exactly how long that's going to be. There was a 70-year period prior to this while they're in Babylon. Babylonian captivity is going to be over. You're going to have Media Persia, Greece, and so forth come across here. But the time schedule is going to be this. Now come with me to Luke chapter 19. Because the interesting thing about all this, in Luke chapter 19, and get Luke 19 in one hand and Psalm 118. Luke 19 and Psalm 118. The reason that the wise men in Matthew chapter 2, the reason that there were people in Jerusalem, Anna and Simeon and so forth, and a whole group of people in Jerusalem looking for the Messiah, living in expectancy of the redemption of Israel, is that they knew that this time schedule was coming to an end. If you knew that the crucifixion of Christ was going to take place after the 69th week, if you were a Jewish believer and a Bible student, you would know that the Messiah was going to have a ministry. He's going to be a prophet, a priest, and a king. So he's going to have a prophetic ministry. He's going to be a priest. He'd have to go into the ministry. He can't go into the ministry till he's 30 years old. So you could back up here and say, if this is the end, at least 30 years before that, he had to be born. So they're able to kind of massage these numbers and kind of have an understanding. So there are people there expecting him to come because they know the time schedule is running out there. Now, Luke chapter 19, this is the day that we're talking about in Mark chapter 11. This is the entry into Jerusalem. You'll see it back in verse 29. It came to pass, Luke 19, 29, when he was come to Bethpage and Bethany at the mount called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, and they go in and they find the donkeys, and they bring them out, verse 35, they brought him to Jesus, and they cast their garments upon the colt and set Jesus thereon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. Verse 37, when he was come nigh, even now to the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now, that is, again, is a quote from Psalm 118. And some of the Pharisees among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he said unto them, I tell you that if these hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. And when he had come near, he beheld the city, and he wept over it. Now watch. Saying, if thou hadst known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things that belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. And he goes on down and describes the thing, verse 44, and shall lay thee, verse 43, for the day shall come upon thee, that thine enemy shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee around, and keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon the other, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. Now that destruction of verse 43 and verse 44 is described in Daniel chapter 9, verse 26. After the 62 weeks, Messiah is cut off, then the city is destroyed, and all that destruction is described there. So Christ is saying, right here, those 69 weeks are over with. At that moment, this is the day that all of the 69 weeks have come to a conclusion. So what's happening here is not just another event. This literally is the day for the conclusion. It's the day of thy day, he calls it, the day of thy peace, the time of thy visitation. Sir Robert Anderson in the 1800s, another fellow just maybe 30 years ago, independent of one another, studied these dates. And I've told you many times, I'm not a chronologist. You know, I've tried, and I get so confused with it, I just say, thank God for people that can do it. You know, you could take Bullinger's Companion Bible, and he's got charts in the back, all this stuff. I read them, and I look at them, and I just go, my eyes cross over. And I just go back and just read the verses. If I'd have needed to know the dates, it'd be in the Bible already. But what Anderson and the other fellow, I can't think of his name, did, is they threw a process of elimination and history, identified the date back here in Nehemiah chapter 2. Then they counted the days that make up 483 days, years of 30 days in prophecy. A month is 30 days. So you have a 360-day year. So they counted 483 times 360, and they came from there, and they say, according to their calculations, that day right there, and they give you the date of it, is that day that we're reading in Luke chapter 19 and Mark chapter 11. So they count the things and say that it's exactly that day. Now, like I said, those dates aren't in the Scripture. The information's there. The historical dates you have to get. There's a book in the bookstore, I think, Sir Robert Anderson's The Coming Prince. It's in there. You can see Mike and Karen, they can get it for you. But that's fascinating. In other words, right down to the exact day, what's happening here is prophecy is being fulfilled. If you go back and look at Psalm 118, you'll see it again. And this is a verse that people, all my young life before I got saved, and I was, the church I was raised in, they used this verse, Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. You've heard that. You see that on Hallmark cards. The Lord made today, let's rejoice and be glad. But that's not what this passage is talking about. When he says, this is the day the Lord has made, he's talking about that thing right there. He's actually talking about the day of the Lord. There they are. He's coming in. And they're quoting Psalm 118, verse 25. Save now. If you took the Hebrew word that is translated save now and you put it into English, it would be the word Hosanna. When they were saying Hosanna, that's a term of praise. But it's really the Hebrew word that's translated save now. Now you can figure that out by looking it up in Webster's dictionary. It's fascinating. In other words, they're quoting the passage. Save now, I beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. So this is the coming in Luke chapter 19, Mark chapter number 11. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. But notice, that coming is the day. So the timing of this event is a fulfillment of prophecy, demonstrating that God has prophesied these things. He comes, if you go back to Mark, he comes sitting on a colt. If you get Matthew chapter 21, maybe we'll pick on that one instead of Luke. Matthew 21. Matthew 21, verse number 1. And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem, there came to were come to Bethpage upon the Mount of Olives. Then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied, and a colt with her. So they find the mother and the baby. Okay? So there's two of them. The mom is grown, the colt is the baby. Loose them and bring them unto me. If any man say aught unto you, you shall say, The Lord hath need of him, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell ye the daughter of Zion, Behold, your king cometh unto you, unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt the foal of an ass. Now that's a quotation from Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. It was the reason he sent for the donkey, and the reason he did the things he did with it, is because the prophecy said the way he's going to come into Jerusalem, the way they're going to know it's him, is because he's going to come upon that colt, the foal, he's going to come upon, mom's going to be there, but he's going to be riding the baby. He's going to be riding the young colt that nobody had ever sat on. In other words, he wasn't broken yet. He wasn't trained to bear a burden. You know what happens when you try to get on a horse that hadn't been broken? Well, you usually don't stay on them very long. Same way with a donkey. You don't really stay on them very long. So Christ is going to sit on it. He's going to take control over this rebellious animal. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But that's the look back at Zechariah chapter 9. And while you're looking for Zechariah 9, get Genesis chapter 49. Zechariah 9 and Genesis 49. This really goes all the way back to Jacob and his prophecies about his descendants. In Genesis 49, sometimes people get a little upset with the Bible when you find in the Bible prophecies about what's going to happen to the descendants. Jacob does it here. Noah did it in Genesis 9. It's done more than once. And it's the kind of thing that God does to lay out prophetically so that you know what's happening, so that you know when it happened. He knew about it ahead of time. Genesis 49. Jacob called unto his sons and said, Gather yourselves together that I may tell you that which should befall you in the last days. Notice Jacob is going to tell his 12 sons, Here's what's going to happen to you, and it's going to happen to you in relationship to the completion of God's purpose in the 12 tribes. It's not just going to be happening in the next three months. This is going to aim at the last days. And when you're looking at the last days, you're looking at God's fulfilling his purpose with Israel in prophecy. Well, that's what the book of Daniel's about. If you come down to verse number 8, verse 9, Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down, he crouched as a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up. The scepter. Now a scepter is the king. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. Judah is the royal line. Jesus, the Messiah, is going to be the lion of the tribe of Judah. And the kingly line is not going to depart. It's not going to go into any other tribe. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come. Now, that town of Shiloh is a town of peace. That's what that means. In other words, Judah's going to be the kingly line until the Messiah, the Prince of Peace, comes. And unto him, that's how you know Shiloh is not the city, it's the him, unto him shall be gathered the gathering of the people. So when the Messiah comes, the Prince of Peace comes, he's going to gather the believers in Israel. When he does it, verse 11, this is a weird verse in a lot of ways. If I say weird, you know I'm not trying to be disrespectful. Okay, it's kind of an odd, very difficult verse to interpret. But it says what it says. Binding his foal under the vine, and his ass's colt under the choice vine. He washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. Now you say, well, what's that? Well, if you read it, you're talking about verse number 10, the Prince of Peace coming, and he's going to gather his people, the believers in Israel, together. And in connecting with that, he's going to bind his foal under the vine and his ass's colt under the choice vine. Well, you wouldn't know what that is by just reading that. But when you come over here to Zechariah chapter number 9, the fact that you learn about in Genesis is kind of amplified for you. Zechariah 9, verse 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold thy king. Here comes Shiloh. Here comes the Prince of Peace. Cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. Well, if you read that and you were a Bible-believing Jew, that might would register. That's what he said back in Genesis 49. So when Judah is told that you're going to have Shiloh, the peace giver, the Prince of Peace, come, and first thing he's going to do is he's going to bind his foal under the vine, connect his people to Israel, and his ass's colt under the choice vine. You say, Zechariah 9 tells you that's the first coming of Christ. You see in verse 9, Zechariah 9, 9, your king comes, but how does he come? Does he come in power and great glory? Is he going to come in power and great glory? Matthew 25, 31, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory with all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. When he comes that way, does he ride a donkey? What's Revelation 19, 11 say? He comes on a white horse. Heaven's open, and the horse, what? He comes on a white charger. Look with me at Psalm 45. Psalm chapter 45. What you've got in those passages in Genesis and in Zechariah is you've got the first coming and the second coming of Christ together in one verse. That happens often in prophecy. That's why Peter says in 1 Peter that the prophets, when they'd write about the sufferings and the glory of Christ, the first coming and the second coming, they couldn't necessarily tell what they're talking about or how they fit together time-wise. Because often they're in the same verse. And when he talks in Genesis chapter 49, that verse number 11, he binds his colt to the vine, and his ass's colt bindeth his foal under the vine, and his ass's colt under the choice vine. That's the first coming. Then when it says he washes his garment in wine and his clothes in the blood of grapes, that's the second coming. That's Isaiah 63. Who is this that cometh with Bozrah with garments that are dyed? And he says, I've been out there treading the winepress of the wrath and all the fierceness of God's wrath. So the first coming, he comes meek and lowly. Second coming, he comes in power and great glory. But you have them all there in one verse in Genesis 49. Because at that time, they didn't have the information you and I have now. Now come with me to Psalm 42. I'm sorry, Psalm 45. This is a psalm about the second coming of Christ. Verse 3 says, gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O most mighty, for thy glory and thy majesty. And in thy majesty ride prosperously because of the truth and meekness and righteousness, and thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies, wherewith the people shall fall. Thy throne. I mean, you read on down through that passage, and you see this war horse coming to do what? Coming to destroy, coming to avenge, coming to set up his kingdom. So what you have in Zechariah 9:9 is not the coming of the king in power and great glory. It's his coming in lowliness and meekness. And the difference between the first coming and the second coming. In fact, in Zechariah 9:10 is when you see the second coming. So you've got the first coming in verse 9, second coming in verse 10. The first coming is being fulfilled in his entry into Jerusalem. But he's not coming in power and great glory. He's coming in a pageantry of poverty, in essence. But he's coming in fulfillment of prophecy, doing exactly what the prophets said he would do. Now, there are a bunch of quotes, and that's one of the things I thought about doing was Matthew and Mark and Luke, when they quote Zechariah 9, they leave out parts of it. They leave out the justice and they leave out the rejoicing because there was no justice. He didn't come to execute justice. He came to execute grace, Zechariah 12. And they don't have salvation then because they rejected it. So Zechariah 9:9 is only partially fulfilled, which tells you there's going to be a later complete fulfillment. And that's where the second coming of Christ takes in. But what you're reading here in Mark 11 and Matthew 21, Luke chapter 19 and John chapter 12, you're reading about the fulfilling of the prophetic program that has to do with Christ presenting himself. Now, he's presenting himself in a very special way. Come back with me, if you will, to the book of John, chapter 12. And this is a point that you really need to kind of grasp. Because as he gathers, he comes in. And if you notice John chapter 12, verse 12, and on the next day much people were come to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming. They took branches and so on and so forth. They could say, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. This is the same event. But you notice in verse 12, on the next day much people were come to the feast. The people that are going to hail him as Hosanna, the King, coming in the name of the Lord, they're not really the citizens of Jerusalem. The event that is taking place that week is the Passover. Look back at chapter 11, verse 55. And the Jews' Passover was nigh at hand. And many went out of the country up to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. And what's happening is all these people from Galilee, where Christ has been, and they've been following him. We've seen that crowd. They follow him now, and they know who he is. And when they see him coming down that Mount of Olives on that donkey, they recognize what's going on. They say, he's the Messiah. We've been watching him. We've been following him. We know who he is. And they're the ones that are crying out, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now you notice in chapter 12, verse 1, then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany. So it's important to understand when this thing took place. 6 days before the Passover, Christ comes to Bethany. The next day, now the Passover is going to take place on the 14th day of the month Abib, which is our April. You'd have 13, the 12th, the 11th, the 10th, the 9th. So you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So he comes to Bethany. By the way, you notice in chapter 12, verse John 12, he came to Bethany where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. The Saturday before he's crucified, he spends the night at Lazarus' house. Now, you know what the leaders in Jerusalem thought about that? They got miffed about it. As Brother Mel would say, they were up the miff tree because of that. And verse number 9, much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted with them, that they might put Lazarus also to death, because by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. So Christ, it's like he's coming and just sticking them in the eye. He's not withdrawing himself. He's coming to make himself known. Now, the next day, which would be the 10th of the month, he comes down off the Mount of Olives. Now, that's going to be Sunday. Okay? Now, the reason that's important, come back with me to the book of Exodus, chapter number 12. Exodus chapter 12. This is the chapter where Israel is brought out of Egypt. This is the chapter where the word Passover was coined by William Tyndale when he translated your Bible into English the first time, back in 1530-something. And he coined this term Passover. It's down in verse number 12. And I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt will I execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood of the Passover lamb, shall be to you for a token upon the house where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. I will pass over you. That's where the name Passover came from. So this chapter is the chapter that Israel originally has their first Passover, where they're delivered out of Egypt. And every Passover after that was a memorial of that redemption out of Egypt. Now come back with me to verse number 2. This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. We call January our first month of the year. For them, this is their first. This is the month when God gave birth to the nation Israel. Now, if you look at chapter 13, verse 4, this day came ye out in the month Abib. Now, before the Babylonian captivity, the month was called Abib. After the Babylonian captivity, they called it Nisan. It corresponds to our month, April. So when you think about the Passover, if you just think about it, now you can get Bible dictionaries and they'll say it's March 15th, to April the 15th, and April the 15th, and pretty soon, you know, you just, you say, what are you? It's just easier to say April. And you say, well, it doesn't exactly correspond. Well, tough apples. I read these books and I see what they're doing. I say, what? So I, you know, you do what you want to with it, but for me, it's just easier to think about it in round terms. And I know that Abib or Nisan corresponds with what we consider the month April. So watch what he says, verse 3. Speak ye unto the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of the month, you should take unto you every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be little, too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make their count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. So what was Israel doing on the 10th day of Abib? They were selecting a lamb. Then they're going to watch that lamb 1, 2, 3 days to make sure that it's without blemish, to make sure it didn't have any imperfections in it. And then after those 3 days, on the 14th day, they're going to kill it. The reason Jesus presented himself on that 10th day, on what we call Palm Sunday. And you know it's Sunday because that would be Monday, that would be Tuesday, that would be Wednesday, and that would be Thursday, and that's the day he died, was on Thursday. I know religion says it was Friday, and fundies say it was Wednesday, but the Bible says it was Thursday. So I know that's Sunday, because you count backwards. But what he was doing, he wasn't presenting himself as the king in his glory. He was presenting himself as the king in his low, his meek and lowly coming. Coming to do what? Coming to be their redeemer. That's where he presents himself in the poverty. He says, go out and get that colt. Think about what he did. He sends these two guys out. And we'll have to talk about why there was two of them next time. But he sends two, and he says, you go over here to this certain location, and there'll be a colt tied, the mama and the baby. And you untie them. He knows exactly where they're going to be. That's wisdom. That's divine foreknowledge. He says, unloose them. And if somebody says anything to you, just tell them, Jesus needs him. And all you got to do is say, Jesus needs him. And the word of the king will say, okay. They'll say, okay. That's authority. But think about the other side of that. Jesus, tell him, the Lord needs him. Well, did you ever think about the Lord needing somebody? That's talking about dependence, poverty. Paul says, knowing the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, though we were rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might be made rich. In what he does, he demonstrates his deity. He is God, but he's God who's become man and lives in our poverty. And I'll save it till next week because we've only got 4 minutes left. But in that colt that never a man rode, look with me, if you will, to the book of Job, chapter number 11. There's something very special about him. So that he's a colt that never a man rode. Job chapter 11, verse number 12. Though vain man would be wise, though man born like a wild ass's colt. You know what a lost man is likened to in the Bible? That wild, rebellious, untamed jackass. You know what that thing says over there in Mark? Look back at Mark chapter 11. Verse 7. They brought the colt to Jesus, cast their garments on him, and he, Jesus, did what? Sat on him. Nobody had ever tamed that colt, but Jesus comes and sits on him, quiets him, controls him, and he carries him into the city. Now, what made the difference? We'll look back at Psalm 110. That colt represented the spiritual condition of the nation Israel. Stiff-necked, stubborn, rebellious, unwilling to be put within the yoke of God's law. And Jesus comes. Psalm 110, verse number 3. Notice number 2. Let's start in verse 1. The Lord is thy, said to my Lord, sit thou on my right hand, and I will make thy enemies thy footstool. Peter quotes that in Acts 2. The Lord shall send the rod of his strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Now watch. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. In the beauty of holiness, from the womb of the morning, thou hast the dew of thy youth. And that colt that Jesus comes down that hill in is a picture of that believing remnant in Israel who, in the day of his power, are willing. They follow him. They trust him. They do what he tells them later, have faith in God. They are the little flock. It's his Father's good pleasure to give the kingdom. And everything in Mark, and especially in Mark, everything that's said about him, and the reason that narrative is there's more about going and getting him and so forth than there is about to ride in, is because that colt is a picture of the transformation that the coming of the Messiah is going to produce in a believing remnant in that nation. You're then going to ride with him into his glory. So, all right, I said we weren't going to get very far in it. We hadn't looked at the verses in Mark 11 really yet, so next time we'll try to do that. But after he comes in, verse 11, he entered into Jerusalem and into the temple. And when he had looked around about upon all things, and now the even was come, he went out. Notice he comes into the city, and Mark doesn't talk about, all Mark does is says he gets on the donkey and he comes in. Everybody says, woo, woo, woo. If you read Matthew, Luke, and John, he comes into the city, he goes into the gates, does all these things. Mark just says, he came in, then he comes in, this display of meek and lowliness. And then he goes to the temple. Malachi says he's going to come to his temple suddenly. And all he does is he looks around. He comes to inspect the very heart of his nation. And he doesn't see anything there that he responds favorably to. They have no place for him. They don't recognize him. The next day, he comes down the road and there's that fig tree. It's got leaves on it. but the time for figs wasn't. It's saying, hey, I got figs. I've got life, but he comes and there's no fruit. And he cursed the fig tree. Fig tree is a type of the life, the religious life of Israel. What did he just see in the temple? He saw all the, they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. And he takes this symbolic action. People get mad at the Lord Jesus Christ for cursing the fig tree. You read commentaries and they'll spend pages trying to explain why Jesus would curse the fig tree. And they miss, this is the only miracle that Jesus ever did that was to destroy people. But what did he do? He just came out of the temple where they had no part in him. And he saw all the hypocrisy in the temple. Now he sees that fig tree professing to have fruit and has none. He cursed it. Then the next thing he does is he goes back into the temple and he cleanses it. And he casts out the money changers. And he stops what they're doing. And when he does that, the Pharisees say, we got to kill that guy. Then he comes out of there. And his disciples say, whoa, look. The fig tree has withered and died. The fig tree in Israel is a representative of the religious life of Israel. And when he says, curse that fig tree, and it says, verse 14, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. That temple worship, that mosaic system, is being done away with. How? That's what he's going to the cross to do. Replace it with a new covenant. Take it away. So what Mark's doing here, there's. I hope I can just give you some of the flavor of what's happening here. There's a tremendous flow of thought. Mark is presenting him as the servant. He doesn't do all the dispensational stuff like Matthew does, and he doesn't do all the personal stuff like Luke does, and he's not focusing on the glory side that John does. He's just, here's the servant. He's the ruler come to serve. And here's the servant that's going to rule. And as he comes in on his way to the cross, he lays the issue in front of them. So we'll have to start back in verse number 2 next time, okay? These are exciting passages for me. It's my conviction, has been for decades, that nobody should know more about the events we're fixing to study than grace believers. Because we appreciate not just the history, but the meaning behind the history in all of its fullness. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace to us in Christ Jesus. We thank you for our Savior, who though he were rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might be rich. We thank you for the riches of your grace in him. And we pray that our lives might appreciate it, our hearts might trust it, and that it might reflect through us the worthiness of our Savior to the world about us. In Christ's name.